Hello, I'm John Doyle, the Artistic Director of Classic Stage Company, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to Classic Conversations. For more than a year now, we've been presenting this series of informal chats between myself and artists that I know and admire. For our summer season, we've chosen four extraordinary luminary ladies who I hope you are going to enjoy meeting. It's my great pleasure this week to welcome four-time Oscar nominee, Marsha Mason.
There we go.
Marsha, how are you?
I'm good.
I love the fact that I'm just seeing the top of your two Golden Globes coming out the top of your head.
Yeah, great. People's Choice and
Nice.
Nice, very nice.
Nice. Why aren't there four Oscars there? That's what's annoying.
Well, they're actually on the other wall.
They're on the walls. Does all that seem like a long time ago?
God, yes. Yeah, yeah. And as I've gotten older, you know, it's really, I mean, in one way for me, it doesn't. You know, it's just because the memories are just as fresh of everything. On the other hand, when I see photographs from the films, then I realize how long ago it was.
Yeah. And I mean, I remember joking once when you came very graciously and introduced a gala for us at Classic Stage.
Yes. Yeah.
I joked about the fact that you introduced me and I had to come up on the stage and I said, you know, I can't believe that I'm standing here having been introduced by the Goodbye Girl. And, you know, we laughed, but it was that particular movie. I don't know if it's just like when I was going to the movies time, but it was like a huge thing, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Yes. And it is to this day. I mean, what's interesting is that thank God for cable, because then people began, a whole other generation began to see it. And now grandchildren, you know, have seen it because their grandmother loved it and their mother loved it and sisters, and, you know, and I still get, you know, responses like that from the Goodbye Girl. I mean, that one was just, and we didn't know, we had no idea.
Really?
No, not at all, because it was a small film, basically. Everything prior to that had been very dark, sort of, and people were kind of like, I remember people complaining or saying to me after it came out, oh, thank God, a picture we can take the family to. And so the cards were really nice. It was in the eon days of when they actually did cards. You know, we went to some small theaters in Pomona or out in California. And and then it just took off.
How exciting.
You know, it was just lucky. You know, we were just really, really lucky.
And did it change life?
No, not really. No, you know, I mean, because being married to Neil was its own sort of thing, and he continued to work and produce. So all of those 10 years where we worked together and everything was a wonderful, creative, professional time for us.
I'm sure. Really, really good.
We had a great time, and he wrote really well during that time, you know.
Yeah. So, yes. Yeah. That was his sort of part of his heyday, wasn't it, really?
Yeah.
I don't know if I've ever shared the story with you. Forgive me if I have, but it's worth telling again. When I first came to New York to audition people for Sweeney Todd,
yeah,
I was in the Telsey casting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And this gentleman came in, elderly gentleman, quietly, charmingly. And I said to him, I think you might be in the wrong room. And he said, no, I don't think so. And I said, well, do you play an instrument? And he said, well, no, not really. And we had this very, very funny conversation. And he left charmingly, said, lovely to meet you, left. And then I thought, oh my God, that was Neil Simon. Because they were casting, I don't know, something, promises or something in the other room.
Right.
Jeez, I've just met Neil Simon.
I know, he was always like that, very low key, you know, laid back.
Quiet. Yeah, and I realized afterwards he was sort of having fun with himself.
Yes.
Like it was refreshing that somebody didn't recognize him.
Yeah, like I think that's true.
Yeah. So listen, you went, you and I have talked about this before, but I know that your days at ACT, the actor in San Francisco, were a big deal. Were you there for a long time with Bill?
No, I was actually only there for one full season, but I did so much work during that season. It was just, again, one of those lucky, you know, destiny type breaks. And I wanted had every intention of going back for a second season. I felt I had died and gone to heaven, because that was the biggest dream I had up until that point, was I wanted to be a working actress, mm-hmm. and yes, in a repertory company, and get to play all those different parts and be part of an ensemble. And to me, that was what it meant to be an actor. And it still means that to a great extent.
Yes, I understand that.
Yeah. So
had you gone straight from St. Louis to New York before going to San Francisco?
Yeah. I went to New York in the late 60s.
Yeah.
And... Oh, no, early 60s, because I graduated school in 65.
Right.
And I went straight to New York.
Right. And so then you auditioned for ACT and got in somewhere along the line in that journey.
Yeah.
And then did you go straight from there to Hollywood?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, that was not planned at all. Wow. What happened was... my first introduction to ACT was I replaced Michael Learned because she had gotten the Waltons, and ACT was committed to a summer package of Private Lives. I told my agent to lie to them and say that I had done the role. I memorized it over a weekend, with the exception of the tea scene, which would be impossible since it was all... business, you know.
Yeah.
And I only had a week's rehearsal, so I had to know it, you know. And then we went out on a little summer package tour, and I just asked the rest of the cast, I said, you know, what do I need to do to apply for the regular fall company? And they said, well, you know, you don't make much money and it's as cast. And I said, that's fine. So Bill Ball came to, he was then the artistic director, along with the director of Private Lives. And we had a presentation, of the rehearsal of the production. And the director was this kind of wild and woolly looking guy with long hair and, you know, everything. Very Italian, yeah. And so he said, come with me afterwards. And he said, you're going to be fine. He said, you're just going to be fine. He said, you just have to remember in the fight scene, you're getting a little contemporary. So he took me for a drive in his brand new car, which he told me he had just won on a bet. And it was a specially designed Mercedes, you know, it was like a Rolls Royce kind of. And he said that, I said, you won it on a bet. And he said, yes. He said, I bet the producer and I of this movie that I just made, we bet it would make, I think, $19 million worldwide. And it was the original Godfather. And it was Ford Coppola. He took me around, told me stories about Marlon Brando and acting type stories. So that, like, he told me, for example, that Marlon wore a very tight pinky ring, so it looked like it had been on his finger for a long time. The cat was also something that he used to help him with the character. He even said, you know, that he put things in his mouth, but he said, I wouldn't recommend that to anybody. And so he said, you ought to get, you know, really, he said, you are the richest woman in the world. So he said, you need something to remind you of your period and that you, you know, you're not a contemporary person. So he said, you know, get the most expensive lingerie. And I said, on the kind of salary I'm making, I don't think I can. But he dropped me off in front of the St. Francis Hotel across the street from the theater. And I went into this little French perfume shop and I bought the most expensive French perfume. And I doused my wig and my underwear and a scarf, a hanky, and the, you know, the pads that they wore under my costume. And I doused it all with that. So I would constantly remember that I was the richest woman in the world. How
adorable is that? That's adorable. People speak about Bill Ball, who was the artistic director there, with great affection, as if he were almost the kind of artistic director that doesn't exist anymore. I mean, like he was a, it sounds like his vision for that theater was incredibly special.
Yeah, he really understood, but you know, it was expensive and it was a full loan repertory company. Amazing. We had something like 70 journeymen. That's why in Cyrano de Bergerac, the bakery scene was filled with people. It was operatic. He raked the stage for Cyrano to an extreme. My costumes were made with lace. Everything was first rate. The clothes were beautiful. They had a full costume shop, all of that kind of thing. Yeah. And the productions were just spectacular.
Almost the European model of how you make
totally, it. Totally. Yeah. Well, he, Guthrie, and who's the other person that sort of established regional theater? You know, I mean, right. He and, you know, Jack O'Brien's mentor, right. Ellis Rabb.
Oh, yeah, indeed.
Yeah.
Indeed.
So those, Ellis and Bill Ball were, you know, acolytes of Guthrie and wanted to, you know.
Yeah. When I worked at Stratford, Ontario, I did a production there. And it, of course, that's a Guthrie theater. And it was the same notion. I mean, in the costume shop, you know, 200 people worked in that costume shop.
Wow.
Oh my God. When you did a fitting with an actor, as the director, you went along with a designer and there was a costume fitting. There would be the cutter, the tailor, the wig person, the jewelry person, the makeup person, the whole, I mean, it was a team of people in that room getting the look right. Remarkable detail. You know, many dying arts. I mean, what was very interesting at Stratford was that a lot of those people were either themselves Eastern European, or they came, or they had been trained by Eastern European tailors and designers, all of whom had come over before the Second World War. And Guthrie and his designer, her name's gone from me right at this moment in time, they, you know, they created a sort of body of people who had very special skills and used them to teach, really.
Yeah. Yeah.
So were you then seen in a show and that's what took you to Hollywood?
Yeah, literally. Well, actually what happened was, it was another one of those destiny type stories. I finished that summer package. I was waiting to hear if I would get into ACT. My agent said, since we finished up on the West Coast, he said, go down to LA and I'll arrange some meetings with casting people for you. So I went over to Warner Brothers when they had their own in-house casting person, Anessa Himes. And I walked into the office and there were scripts all around the office for Bloomin' Love, Now, in New York, prior to leaving for the tour, I had auditioned for that movie with Paul Mazursky, and I thought I had done really well, but I didn't get it. So I thought, you know, and I saw these scripts around when I go into Warner Brothers, and I thought, oh, you know. So I'm sitting there just beginning the interview with Nessa, and she gets a phone ring. She answers it, and she goes, she's sitting right here. No. So she said, okay. As she hangs up the phone, she said, we can meet later. Go up the back stairs. Paul Mazursky is pulling his hair out because the actress that he hired for the role that you auditioned for wants to do another film for Warner Brothers, and it conflicts, so he has to cast it again. So I go up the back stairs of that building, and I sit there, and I audition with Paul Mazursky again. He's pulling out his hair and everything, and he said, okay, you can do the part. And then I said, when do you start shooting? And he told me, and I went, oh my God. And he said, what? And I said, well, I made a promise to ACT and Bill Ball, and I think there might be a problem with some of the dates. And he said, you want to have an out clause on your first contract? So I said, let me call Mr. Ball. So I run home, I call Bill, and he said, I told him the story about memorizing. So he said, you come in knowing your lines, and I'll use an understudy for the first week of Cyrano.
How fantastic.
And that's what he did. And I then, of course, though, it was a very intimidating first day because they chose the bakery scene. And so everybody was there wondering, who is this person that we've been waiting for? I mean, because I was an unknown, they wouldn't have known me, you know? Sure. No, because both pictures wound up coming out. And then Cinderella Liberty, what happened is Mark Rydell was trying to find the right leading lady. He was talking to Paul. Paul said, let me show you this rough footage of this kid that I just, you know, she's up at ACT. He called me one day and said, I'd like to come up and see your show. He said, I'm doing this movie. Maybe we could get together for coffee and talk about it. So I said, well, what play do you want to see? And he said, How many are you in? I said, well, right now, 4. Because we were in repertory.
Of course.
So I think he wound up coming and seeing me in Doll's House. So, yeah. And I said, now listen, we just started, so I'm not up to the best. And he said, never mind, I'm just coming. So they came, he and Jimmy Kahn came. And he hired me for Cinderella Liberty. Yeah.
Which is a long way away from a Doll's House.
Yeah. But you know, because Paul and Mark had been actors, because they had done live theater and had been trained in New York, and so had Jimmy. Jimmy was trained at the Neighborhood Playhouse. Uh-huh. So they got it. You know what I mean? They understood what an actor can do.
So do you think that you were part of it, or you still are, but in Hollywood, were you part of a generation of actors who were actually stage actors first and foremost?
Yeah.
Because many actors now, they could walk in off the street and become a movie star.
That's right. Yes, because if you think about it, it's Bobby De Niro, it's Dreyfus, it's Jane Fonda, everybody had trained, you know, and everybody had done New York.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
Ellen, all of them. Yeah.
Yeah. They were proper actors.
Bedford, you know. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then, so, and please don't think me, you know me well enough that I wouldn't want to be improper in any way, but when you married Neil, did you feel that you had become kind of his muse? I mean, he was writing for you, wasn't he? Was that? How did that feel?
You know, it was very interesting in the sense that I remember I was playing, we went to a tennis thing in Caesar's Palace or something, and I met a couple, and they could never work together, they said, or they couldn't even play tennis together. And it was very curious to me because Neil and I seemed to have a really flawless professional relationship. I think because we mutually admired each other, we respected our work. He was very proud of me, but he was kind of surprised at some of the things I could do.
Yeah.
Like he told Jack O'Brien once that he thought that I couldn't do his material because my rhythms were very different from his. But I wound up going to London and did a revival of, Prisoner at Second Avenue with Dreyfus.
Yes.
He came to rehearsals and he came to, you know, the opening and everything. And he said, you know, I'm just always been amazed. And even with Lily Tomlin was supposed to do not Murder by Death, but the other one, The Cheap Detective. Mm-hmm. And at the last minute, she wound up having a conflict with her one person show. And so she couldn't do it. And it was very late. It was, you know, they were getting ready to shoot because the costume was made and everything. And I blurted out, let me read, let me audition. And Neil said, no, you're not right. You know, so I wound up getting it. But it was one of those things. Yeah. You know?
So after that time, did you choose to leave Hollywood? Did you feel your time was done there?
Yeah. It was very hard. It was tough in the 80s because things got really, really youth oriented. Mm-hmm. There was a more corporate structure, mm-hmm. You know, in terms of how movies were made and also how they previewed and focus groups, and that all started. But mostly it was a youth movement in the movies, including, you know, even the executive roles and stuff. Some of the older gentlemen that I worked under, you know, like Ray Stark and everything, they were on their way out. And also as a single woman in those days, in the 80s, people drop you, you know what I mean? Because they have to decide, you know? And so Neil was still producing and still a very big name in his own right, rightfully so. But so I lost a whole 10 years of friends and life and everything. And my two daughters had grown up. They were on their own. And so I just suddenly hit one of those kinds of moments in life where you just say to yourself, it's not happening. It's not in the flow. It's not, I don't feel comfortable. I mean, I tried. I stayed there for 5 years after I divorced. I built a house. I had a life. I continued to work, but not as much. And so my friend Shirley McLean said she was going to buy some property in New Mexico. And I loved New Mexico. And my first husband was from New Mexico. And so I knew a little bit about New Mexico. And I took some trips out there. And one day I just saw some property and I thought, I'm just going to throw all the pieces of my kaleidoscopic life up in the air and see what pattern comes down. And I spent 20 years there.
I know.
Yeah.
I mean, incredibly courageous, really, you know, to make
that. You don't know it at the time, though.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, you don't know that at the time.
It was a
very important thing for me because the success in film was not planned and I was really kind of not ready for it. It overwhelmed me. I didn't know how to handle it. I was very insecure. I wasn't prepared really to take advantage of it. And to some extent, it was overcast because it was mostly with Neil. So there was, you know, a whole kind of identity issue that I wound up having to deal with after working like, you know, a 12-cylinder engine. Sure. And now I was, you know, only working on eight.
Do you think that thing of, you know, as you said at that time, and I think it continued for a long time, that, you know, the star roles were getting younger and younger and younger. But do you think that's shifting back? I mean, do you think with people like Frannie McDormand and her Oscar, you know what I'm saying? Do you think there is a movement back toward the older, the real character actor in terms of leading roles in movies?
But I think it often winds up being one of a kind. It's sort of like Jane Fonda, you know, with Grace and Frankie, or Frances. I mean, when you go back, I was thinking about it. They used to have character actors who were stars, you know, in the 30s, 40s, and even 50s, Thelma Ritter and people like that. That quality still, you don't see it. And part of it is because it was one of the things with Only When I Left that I liked so much is it was really an ensemble.
Yes.
With some young character people in it. There were five of us, really, four. Yeah. And they don't make those kinds of pictures.
No.
And so it's, but in the independent world, it's possible. Yes.
Yes.
But generally speaking, it's one person. You know, it's Ellen Burstyn or Jane. Do you know what I mean? Or certainly Meryl must get offered everything.
Oh, God.
You know what
Daily.
I mean? Yeah.
Daily. But I mean, somebody like Ellen, who's a close friend of mine, she presumably, I mean, you know, I know that Ellen went through many years of not being offered work.
Right, right.
No, I mean, she was there. If anything, her real heyday was ever so slightly before you, you know, Last Picture Show and Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore, those movies were just a little before you. And then she went through a whole period of her life where she really wasn't getting the work.
Yeah.
And came back to New York. And I think that she lived a lot of her life in New York. And now suddenly, you know, all that wonderful work, really.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So you hope for it, you know?
Yes, that's right.
I was reading about the lovely actress who played Angelica in Hamilton. And you wouldn't know it to look at her, but she's 50. And there was an article today about how it's come late for her. But meanwhile, she continued to try, you know, and she did work, but, you know, nothing really broke through until Hamilton. And then she got there.
When you went to New Mexico, I mean, and you were there for a long time, I know. Did you kind of basically stop working in the arts?
No, I continued to work whenever they offered it to me because I wasn't that far from LA.
No.
I did do a place, and I actually wound up doing Prisoner in London while I lived in New Mexico.
Uh-huh.
I would come home and I would have gotten all of the day's reporting from the farm, and then I would sit up and fax back all the instructions and the sign checks and the this or the that, and I would FedEx it or I would use the fax machine. And that's how I stayed involved. But I wound up, I think it was 6 months in London.
Good God. So you kept your business going at the same time.
Yeah.
But I mean, you are, you know, you've struck me as that kind of lady all the time that I've known you of. You get on with things, like you build houses and you know, you've always got a project of some sort or another.
True. Yes.
It's true, isn't it? I mean, where did that come from? Was that your parents? Were they like that?
No, not at all. No, that's just me. I mean, even my sister isn't like that.
Interesting.
I know.
where did the car racing come from? For God's sake.
Well, you know, it was around that same period. It was the early 80s. And I didn't have that much to do, but I was living in LA, having built one of my houses out in the Palisades and hoping for work. And I was on a flight back to New York, and my friend Paul Newman was on it. So we got to talking. We knew each other, he and Joanne, socially. So I said, "What are you doing?" And he said, "Oh, I've got a race out in Riverside." And I, of course, knew about his racing. And you see, when I was in high school, I had a best friend whose father had bought a rundown racetrack outside of the city. And on Sundays, we'd go to early mass, and then we'd run out to the racetrack, and I would hand out the pit passes to all of the drivers who had funny cars, you know, because they were just using the straightaway for, you know, that kind of racing. So I was always intrigued to see these young men, you know, with their cigarettes rolled up in their sleeves and working, and each piece of the motor was wrapped in oil cloth, and it was just fascinating to me.
Oh.
So I said to Paul, "Can I come out and see you race?" He said, "Sure." Well, I stayed that weekend out there, kept out of the way and just quietly watched. And then I asked the manager of the team, I said, "Where are you going next?" So I wound up traveling with his group whenever I could. They got me a hotel room or a motel room, and I just hung out with everybody and watched it. And finally, Paul said to me, "You're nuts." He said, "Why don't you go to school?" And I didn't know the head schools.
Oh, no, did I?
But yeah. So I went to Bob Bondurant's school. I went to John Russell's school. I went to Skip Barber's school. I went to all three of these schools and learned how to race. And then one of the guys who was in one of my classes was a lawyer from LA, Mark and Steinberg. And he said, "You know, I'm gonna buy a little car and just race, you know, 'cause there was a track, Willow Springs, and it was about an hour and a half away from LA. So I said, "That sounds like an interesting idea." So I bought myself a little Mazda, and we had a little mom and pop group, and we had volunteer guys to help us. And I got my license. I went to the school there, and then I got a temporary license. And then I took the thing, and they put a big X on the back of your car so that everybody knows that you're a newbie. And I met a wonderful guy, Mike Lewis, who was a big championship racer who also happened to race Mazdas. And he came up to me one day and he said, "You want to do an arrive and drive? I've got a great car. You'd be good in it." So I said, "Okay." We wound up racing for 7 years. We had a big truck. We had three cars. We had a crew. We had a crew chief. We did the whole thing. And I raced for about 7 years. I went to the Valvoline runoffs 5 times.
Good God.
I brought the car home. You know, I had a great time.
So what made you then come east again? What made you come back to New York?
After the 20 some odd years on the farm and everything, it's expensive. It's exhausting. And, I had done a product line and I felt that I had learned as much as I could possibly learn. I mean, I learned to be a businesswoman. I learned to be a manager of people. I learned patience from nature. I learned that my identity was no longer wrapped up in my work.
Yes, wonderful. And
so I grew up there in a way, I feel. And I've always felt like I was a late bloomer anyway. But then when I finally said, if I'm really, really want to try and get back to those early roots in the theater, even though rep doesn't exist much anymore, but be in that world, which I always loved and was always my first love. And I always tried to do it, you know? So I did do off-Broadway and I did do regional work and stuff like that. And I eventually sold the farm. It took a while because it was a big piece of property, 250 acres. So,
sure.
But it kept its, the new owners have kept it organic and biodynamic. So that's really
beautiful.
Yeah. And I've downsized and simplified.
Sure.
Yeah.
Although I've been to your home in Connecticut, it's not so downsized. I mean, you know.
It is compared to.
But it's still placed in the most beautiful field. I mean,
Nature, I can't live with. I mean, I know that that's true. I can't live with that nature. So
now you, I mean, I know we've all had this enforced pause on our journeys, or although that's not perhaps the best way to put it, because it's still part of the journey, I think, what we've been through in the last 18 months. But, you know, you were mixing up acting and directing and teaching. Is that what you want to go back to? Do you see that cocktail as being the way forward for you?
Yeah. And especially the directing. And I picked up teaching again at HB Studio when I can. And I love directing now. And I have a couple of real creative, interesting projects.
Great.
I don't know if they'll happen or not, because I'm actually trying to help write a book for a musical of a movie that I did, which, you know, who knew? And then another project with acrobats and all about, you know.
Oh, I remember you told me about that project. Yeah,
so we're still on it. And the wonderful people at the Alley Theater are interested, and so are, interestingly enough, some Australian producers, because the playwright is Australian.
They make some good theater over there. They do some good work over there.
Yes, they do. Well, and because they're subsidized again.
Yeah. Hello, that's the answer to a lot of it. Yes. So where did you find the acrobats? Did you work with a company?
Yep. We went to Montreal through a series of acquaintances that Tony had. We went to Montreal and we worked with about five or six acrobats at Sept Toits de la Main in Montreal, which is a separate group, very similar to Cirque du Soleil and all of that.
They're a wonderful group. I met them recently. They are, yes, I've forgotten the woman's name at this moment in time, who's the sort of artistic director.
Shauna?
Yes,
Shauna, yes. And that's who I worked with, was her.
Delightful.
Wonderful woman.
Oh, my God. Really, I mean, like a real old soul, you know. I mean, really special, I thought.
Yes.
Very,
yeah.
Very interesting people.
Yeah.
A facility there, too, don't they? They have, did you?
Oh, when we went a couple of years ago now, they were in the process of just beginning a renovation of a big building that the government helped subsidize for them. I'm dying to see it because they must have been in it now for at least a year. So,
yes. Anything you want to ask me?
Well, what do I want to ask you? You know, I just love your theater. There is something so special about that space that is just, I think about that a lot. And I love the approach you have of kind of paring everything away until you really understand what it is, and then maybe, you know, moving it around a little differently. I mean, it's a real, to me, it's a very visionary director who can do that. And that's always been the most wonderful thing. And I was curious about where you learned everything that you bring now.
I don't know really is the truth. Look, I don't come from a background of theater. I don't think you do either, do you? I mean, you
We never went.
Yeah. I didn't see anything until I went to theater school.
Yeah, me too.
But I was an only child, and I lived, I suppose, a perfectly happy only child, but I lived in my imagination a lot.
Yeah.
We didn't have any money as a family.
Right.
But it's so funny that my parents, my mom in particular, had a house, a tiny house, full of stuff, right? You could barely move. You know, you had, as people had in those days, there was always a table, a little low table in the middle of the room, you know, and all that. Yeah. And I remember as a teenager thinking, when I grow up, I'm not going to have all this shit. I'm going to have very little in my life physically. And of course, I've not really been able to fulfill
that. As I look at all the wall behind you and all the things.
Look, well, of course, you know who I'm married to, so that's a whole other thing altogether. Yes. No, I mean, I love things, don't get me wrong. But I, in my, what I did, I think, was channel that notion into my work about how do you do it with very little. Now, then I started a company in the Highlands of Scotland, where I come from, way back in the early 80s. No money, a tiny little truck van that we moved around in, you know, those little touring companies. And we had three boxes that we could put all our things into, and then the three boxes became the set. So you were asking the audience always to use its imagination. Then for many years, I did what everybody else did. You know, I did Private Lives with a set that was beautiful and French windows and a balcony. And, you know, I could do all that stuff and things flying in and out and musicals. And I got to a point of thinking, this is all very lovely, but it's not me. It's not who I am somehow. And I thought, I've got to get back to those three boxes. I've got to somehow get back to something simpler. And I'm very influenced by people like Peter Brook, who has very little of everything.
Yeah.
I'm not really interested in kind of, I'm never very good with words about how you make theatre, but I'm never very interested in realism. I mean, I think movies do reality much better than the theatre, if you know what I'm saying. You know, we should be doing things that are theatrical. And to me, what's interesting about theatricality is that you can't make it unless there's an audience in the room. You've got to have the audience's imagination.
Yeah.
So our play that we did was only a few chairs and those big mirrors, right? That's all it was. Now, it didn't mean that we could have done it without the mirrors, actually, but in a way, they were the motif of the play.
Yes, they were.
Right? Yeah. They were the motif. Yeah. And as we knew the play more and as the production developed beyond my rehearsing it, people would use those mirrors in different ways. That was always part of the journey of it. I've always been interested in that, about, okay, let it grow when I leave. Let's see what happens to it. And so that's a long way of answering. I don't know that I ever was taught to do what I do. I've never been in a rehearsal room with another director, so I don't know what that feels like. But I just decided that it was time to go back and look at putting myself into the work and not trying to be another director, you know? Not trying to be Hal Prince, just be John Doyle. That's okay. If it's not enough for somebody, then that's okay. Doesn't matter. Well,
when I saw your Sweeney Todd, I was just mesmerized because nobody thought to give the instruments to the actors. Do you know what I mean? And the just utilizing that space and the audience, and what's so wonderful is you can look across or to the side and you can see the audience totally engaged and enveloped in the storytelling.
That's right. I mean, it's the ultimate kind of mirror up to nature. The audience is literally seeing itself as it watches the work, which I think is a fantastic thing. And I think for me, you know, you use the word about what you signed up for when you did when you worked with Bill Ball in San Francisco. For me, the most important word has always been ensemble. That's what I'm interested in. Yeah, and believe me, as you know, I mean, I've worked with some big stars in the theater.
Yeah. But,
you know, you mentioned Sweeney Todd. You know, there's no bigger musical theater star or diva, whatever you want to call it, than Paddy.
I know.
He was totally a member of that ensemble.
Oh, Well, because of those years at Juilliard.
That's it.
Yeah.
And was hungry to be a member of that ensemble.
Yes, there's something about ensemble performing that just,
Also that you're, you know, so many, it happened to you, as you said, in the movies, it happened to Patty in the theater, many people. You're suddenly discovered, right? You're suddenly put on a pedestal. Uh-huh. And wait a minute, I just want to be part of the family.
I
want to be treated special. And then that being treated special leads to another kind of behavior. And if you go back to the ensemble nature, all that behavior goes away.
Yeah.
And the story becomes the thing.
The play is the thing. Yeah.
The play is the thing.
Yeah. So
take great care. You look wonderful.
Oh, you too. Thank you.